I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, I'm gonna let the reason out that his love goes on forever. I'm gonna take it all the way.
Thanks for joining me here on the Maple Minute. This Tuesday, December 6, 2022, I'm Pastor Bill. We've been talking about building quality relationships, quality friendships. And the last episode or so, we talked about how quality friendships disintegrate, or how friendships disintegrate. And what we can do about that is what we're going to talk about today. In fact, today we're going to call applying God's remedy. So what's the cure for a disintegrating, a crumbling friendship? That is something that's worth saving. Jesus gives us the answer to this, and I know we've been dealing a lot with David and Jonathan in the Old Testament, but Jesus actually gives us the remedy for this over in Matthew chapter 5, part of his Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24, it indicates four steps we could use to help us with this remedy for a disintegrating relationship or friendship. And these are so important. They're very simple, too. Not anything that's mind-blowing, but yet something we have to be reminded of every once in a while. Number one, let's go ahead and read the verses, I'm sorry. Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24, it says, Jesus speaking, therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and reconcile to them, then come and offer your gift. Now, Jesus in their day, when he's talking about this altar, he's not talking about your church altar or anything else. He's actually referring to the altar of the temple. Which would have been very understandable for those who are first century Jews. They would line up. They were required to give their sacrifices, and so they would line up. And can you imagine how long this line was for all these people to come in and give their get in line and give their sacrifice at the altar? And he says here, if you're in this long line and you've been waiting like Disney type hours to ride a ride, and you're standing there forever, and then you remember that you've got something wrong between you and another person, you need to take care of that and leave. And that's such a shocking statement that Jesus gave to these people, because they all knew how long it took them just to get that place in the line. And so Jesus gives us at least four things I can see in this passage here that we need to do, steps to do to help our friendships from disintegrating. First of all, the number one thing, as we got into it just a second ago, is we need to admit. See, unless we're willing to face the facts about the difficulties in our relationship with others, we can't know God's blessings on our friendships. We need to deal with the issues as soon as they're perceived. I think one of the hardest things sometimes is just to admit there's a problem. Irritants that are wished away don't vanish. some of you have that personality, you hate confrontation so much that you just rather ignore things. And, you know, honestly, ignoring rather than admitting is actually the path to a destructive relationship, a disintegrating friendship, but it causes it to accelerate. It really does. See, those irritants won't go away by ignoring them, just like when you're sick and you have a cold or a virus or something. If you ignore it and don't take care of it, it's not going away on its own either. Sometimes you have to have some medicine. Sometimes you have to have rest. Sometimes you have to have the right treatments involved. What happens in this case is, if we don't admit there's a problem, those irritants, those things that are destroying our friendships, they will not. They don't vanish just because we wish them to go away. They start flourishing unnoticed, probably, until the pressure is so immense that you see this eruption like that volcano out in Hawaii that's erupted. And by the time that happens, only drastic measures could resolve what could have been probably handled pretty easily if we just, step one, gone to the person, admit it. That's what Jesus says. Admit it. The minute you realize there's a problem, go admit it. Then number two, not just admit, but initiate. I think it's important to realize that, according to Jesus, the onus is not on the other person, the offending party or the offender, or the offended, I'm sorry. But both parties have to resolve the issue. It's not one. My dad always used to say this, and I don't know if it makes sense to you, but he always said, and my dad had a lot of these crazy sayings, but he said, it takes two to tango. It really does. And I think whenever we become aware of a problem, what we have to do is immediately take steps to resolve the problem, regardless of who is to blame. In fact, I've been around people who love to play that blame game so much, and it's so counterproductive to anything. And all it does is make us more selfish. It really is. We need to admit there's a problem and then initiate whatever we need to do, initiate the response to that problem, even if we're the person not causing it necessarily, although it does take two to do that. Number three, we find correct. See, reconciliation is a priority over even worship, according to Jesus. When you think about it, he was telling them they're standing in line to worship at the altar, and if there's a problem, you need to stop your worship and go get your reconciliation on. That's God. That's Jesus saying that. See, there's a holy urgency about our responsibility. We're supposed to go and do it now, not wait. Don't wait for the next day, the next convenience. You know, honest confrontation can only solidify a friendship. And unresolved conflicts, they harden like concrete over time. And it's so sad. I've seen family members who can't get along, all these different areas. And you know, reconciliation is a present duty. It's something that should be acted on and corrected right away. The alternative is to set in motion a disintegration process of friendships, just like Saul did in his relationship to David. Notice how quickly Saul went from liking David to just hating him and wanting to kill him. Why? Because he didn't correct any of the problems. He wasn't putting that as a priority in his life. So we have admit, initiate, and correct. And number four, it is love. this great concern in all believers does not... in all the believers does not... does is to act, let me get it out right. The great concern in all the life of believers is to act in love, and that's the truth of the matter. I know I stumbled over that, but the emphasis is not on a feeling or emotion of love, it's on the acting of love. That's what Jesus was saying here in Matthew 5, 23 and 24. You see, in the relationships of Saul and Jonathan to David, they both had one, but both of them begin with this affection, which really didn't have the quality direction to it. But Jonathan's relationship was built more on not just a lovey-dovey, you know, fondness or an emotional attachment, but on meeting his friend's needs. He was a giver, where Saul was the opposite. He was a taker. And so the friendship between David and Jonathan flourished, where Saul, on the other hand, being such a taker, he looked to meet David, not to meet David's need, but for David to meet his needs. And so he couldn't practice a true sacrificial love, and that's what we're talking about. We're talking about that. He was a taker, not a giver. You see, when love is not practiced, disintegration is inevitable, and I'm talking about the right kind of love. I'm talking about that self-sacrificial love that God gave to us. That's why Jesus was the best person to talk about this, because Jesus showed us what true love was all about. So as we wrap up today, let's look at a few questions to think about. First of all, why do you think it's so hard to face the facts and deal with the issues when it comes to friendships? Have you ever had a friend you didn't feel you could be honest with? And if so, why? And that, I know those seem strange, but those really are important questions to ask. Number two, when there's a problem in a friendship, how easy is it to place blame on the other person? And does this help, and why do we do it? Because it's obviously we do it. And then last of all, honest confrontation may be one of the most difficult aspects of friendships. Why do you think this is? And how easy is it to ignore rather than to confront? These are some great questions to ask in review of what we talked about a little bit today, as we want to build some quality friendships, not friendships that are based on false lies and end up falling apart, disintegrate. So as you go through it, as always, I'd encourage you to take time, pause the video if you need to, write these questions down in a journal, and then take time to answer them. If you have a trusted friend, spouse, somebody you can really be honest and open with, an accountability partner, it's great to share with them and let them share back with you. And then as you're raising kids, maybe even grandkids or young adults in your house, it'd be great to sit down and talk with them, see how they're dealing in their friendships or relationships, because really life is all about our relationships. So I encourage you to keep growing and moving forward in your life with Christ, and help someone else along the way by sharing out what you know and what God's taught you. Until next time, thanks for joining me here on the Maple Minute.
I'm gonna praise Jesus' name, 'cause His love goes on forever. His love reaches to the highest mountain. His love stretches to the lowest valley.